Good evening. My name is Albert Gao. I'm a postdoc at SFI, and my work focuses on how animal groups, including ant colonies, bird flocks, and schools of fish, make decisions together, and particularly on the conditions under which groups can make better decisions than individuals and when they fail. Before I introduce tonight's speaker, Jessica Flack, I want to say a few words about the support that has allowed this community lecture series to be presented at no cost. The lecture series is brought to you by the Santa Fe Institute, with additional support from the Santa Fe Reporter and the Lenzic Performing Arts Center. However, this particular lecture has been underwritten by the Miller Omega Program, which funds projects, individuals, and events that aspire to explore the frontiers of our understanding of the complex universe. So we want to extend a sincere thank you to Bill H. Miller for his generous and continued contributions to SFI. Jessica Flack is a professor here at SFI and runs the Collective Computation Group. Her research, as she'll explain in much more detail tonight, deals broadly with the ways in which collective systems, or large systems of interacting parts, can perform novel computations that the individual components that comprise the system cannot. The kinds of collective systems that she thinks about are extremely wide-ranging and include neurons making decisions, troops of macaque monkeys resolving conflicts, the performance of sports teams, and even cryptocurrencies. Her work draws on evolutionary theory, cognitive neuroscience, statistical mechanics, information theory, dynamical systems, and theoretical computer science to tackle general questions regarding the emergence of biological space and time, coarse graining, causality, and robustness. Some of my own work has been in collaboration with Jess, including projects on the behavior of slime molds and on the wisdom of crowds. Jess did her undergrad at Cornell and her PhD at Emory, where she was in a neuroscience and cognition program. Her thesis focused on robustness, and as part of it, she designed the first knockout experiment, a technique usually reserved for studying genetics, on social systems. Jess's long association with SFI started almost 20 years ago while she was a grad student, attending SFI's Complex Systems Summer School in Budapest. Incidentally, the speaker for our next community lecture, Melanie Mitchell, was actually the director of that summer school back in 2001. Jess then did a postdoc fellowship at SFI before joining the faculty here. Unfortunately, she left Santa Fe for 3.5 years to become the founding director of the Center for Complexity and Collective Computation at the University of Wisconsin in Madison, but thankfully returned to SFI after that. Jess is known to think about science while surfing on Maui's North Shore, long distance running in the Pecos Wilderness, and, as I can attest to from personal experience, cooking incredibly delicious meals. And on top of all of that, Jess is the chair of public events at SFI, and in that role, has played a leading part in bringing this entire community lecture series to you. Please join me in welcoming Jessica Flack.
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be up here, and thank you, Albert, so much for that lovely introduction. It's great to have Albert introduce me because I work with him at SFI on projects related to what I'll be talking about tonight, so that's always fun. So yes, normally I'm up here, or you see me if you come to these lectures regularly, standing in the corner. I organize the series with the help of a great team, and since I'm up here, I'm going to take the opportunity to thank a few people on that team. First and foremost, Caitlin, Laura, up here in the front, Della, Patrizia, Scott, who runs the technology in the back with the help of the great Lenzic crew, Michael Garfield and Jenna Marshall are often behind the scenes doing fantastic communications for the Institute. Am I forgetting anyone? Is that everyone? I think that's everyone. Okay. Yes, thank you. I also want to take the opportunity, since I'm up here, to thank two more people who never get thanked but are really responsible for not only keeping the Institute alive but keeping it running at light speed. And of course, we all know that running an Institute is a thankless job. So let's give a round of applause to President David Krakauer and Vice President Jennifer Dunn. All right, now let me find my presentation. Okay. All right, so tonight I'm going to be talking about my work, Collective Computation of Reality in Nature and Society. And I want to say a few things up front. So this is my own view of things at SFI, but broadly speaking, and Albert alluded to this in his introduction, there's sort of two types of people at SFI. There are people who have developed profound methods and tools like in network science. And by now, and that's been going on for a long time, there are textbooks written on this stuff. And so they're up here giving talks, and they're more pedagogical in some respects. And then there are some of us at SFI who are sort of working on the frontier. There are no textbooks for this stuff yet. And that's my talk tonight. So keep that in mind as I'm going through this material. Another point I want to make is that throughout my talk, there'll be four poems. And this is a bit of an experiment for me. I love to read poems. And I also believe that communication and conveying complicated concepts can sometimes be done better by sort of working, balancing off different perspectives. And so three of the poems are going to make science points, or they're going to make points that reinforce some science points that I'm making. And one is going to make a sociological point that's important. So I won't interpret them, I'll read them. I won't interpret them, it'll be up to you to see the relevance. And maybe you won't see any, maybe you'll think they're perfect. We'll see. Okay, so a couple of weeks ago, The New Yorker published its technology issue. I couldn't be more pleased to see this cover. It's such a beautiful cover. It's by Christoph Niemann. You may know he's really a great illustrator. And let's just have a look at it for a moment. Thought it was a fabulous backdrop for the first sentence of my abstract, which is perhaps a bit provocative. Yeah, it's great. The first computers were not made by humans, but by nature, right? Okay, so I'm going to start with some examples, and we're going to go through them sort of quickly. They're just to give you a sense of the range of computation in nature. And I need to start by introducing one concept which is going to come up over and over throughout my talk, and that's the concept of a circuit. And I will say more in more detail what a circuit is later, but for the time being, what you need to know is that it's different from a network. So if you come to these lectures often, you will have seen lots of images of networks up on the screen. And a network, usually, it's like Facebook. You're connected to people on Facebook. That's a network. And then the networks you see on the screen have nodes or dots, and those correspond to individuals. And then between the individuals are edges. That means they're connected in some way, usually by interaction, so forth. A circuit is a little different. It's related, but it's a little different. The circuits I'll be talking about, in general, the edges are physical or causal connections. And the nodes can still be individuals or other components of biological systems. And in general, the circuits take an input, some data, and they produce an output, some behavior. So that's also different from a network. Okay, so that'll do for now. So one of the first examples that I want to go over just very quickly is probably the most canonical example of computation in biology. And those are the gene regulatory circuits that compute traits and features of the body plan in developing animals. So for example, this gene regulatory circuit that I'm showing here, it specifies the gene interactions whereby genes are turned on or expressed to produce a feature of the sea urchin while it's developing, so in the larval stage. In this particular case, it's something very specific. It's the developing layer of the skin, the endomesoderm. All right, so this complicated circuit is responsible for computing that particular feature of the sea urchin. And there are tons of these circuits in biology for these kinds of traits. And this comes from the work of Eric Davidson, the late Eric Davidson, who was at Caltech, and his colleagues. It's very rigorous and very great, beautiful work. Here's another example I recently found that's quite exciting. So this is, these images that I've got here on the screen are heart cells, they're heart muscle cells. And this particular example is how heart muscle cells, there are nanotube little circuits in these cells that compute relaxation and contraction behavior of the cell. So this is a new discovery. In fact, for a very long time, the sort of standard view of intracellular communication, that is, how communication would take place among organelles in the cell was that it occurred through diffusion. Signals would be sent through the cytoplasm, which is that liquidy stuff that you see inside cells, and they would sort of diffuse across the cytoplasm in that way. That's how the communication, the computation would take place. But it turns out that recently discovered in these heart cells is that there's this incredible web of wires that allows these signals to perform their computations. So we can think about that as an example of an intracellular worldwide web. That's how it was described in the press anyway. Okay, another one, this is also super fascinating, it's a new one too, comes from geobacteria. And these geobacteria breathe, so to speak, by projecting tiny protein filaments called nanowires into the soil. And the purpose of these nanowires is to dispose of excess electrons that build up from the conversion of nutrients to energy. All right? Now, these bacteria often form mats in the soil. And the mats are several layers deep. Okay, so here we have a bacterium. This is an artist's rendering of the nanowires coming off one of these bacterium. And this is a sort of web or a power grid of connected bacteria via these nanowires. So these bacteria, they form mats in the soil that are several layers deep. And the bacteria at the bottom have to break down a compound called hydrogen sulfide. And as they do, they release electrons. And the electrons flow upward along this cable system created by the bacteria to the surface, where more bacteria employing a different metabolic reaction take the electrons and combine oxygen and hydrogen to make water. Now, a fun fact about this system is that 1 square inch of sediment can contain 8 miles of these wires. That's just amazing. So this is quite a circuit. And there's a really interesting article by Carl Zimmer in the New York Times that sort of explains all of this very clearly if you're interested. Okay. Another example is how the brain computes. So I'm not going to, I could give an entire talk on this, and there are many people who could give a much better talk than I could on this topic. It's a very rich area of neuroscience, how the brain computes. It's perhaps the central question of neuroscience. So how do all those neurons in our brain, and there are a lot of them, we're going to come to that in another slide in just a few minutes, each of which has its own, and I'm speaking, of course, colloquially here, its own impression of the world, its own sort of data about how things work. How do all those neurons come together in our brain, right, with all these different opinions to make for the, so that the organism, like the monkey that's here and tasked with looking at this screen and deciding which way the dots are moving, how do all those neurons come together so the brain can make a unitary coherent decision? That's the problem of collective computation in neuroscience. All right. And the model of collective computation, which I'll introduce in the second half of the talk, is based on work that we do on neural systems and work others have done, and on several other systems that we've looked at too. Okay. Now, a fun example of collective computation, of course, comes from the social insects. So social insects like ants and termites adaptively compute architectural properties of their nests and hives to match the environment. And there's some great work by Guy Theraluz and Deborah Gordon and others on this topic, which I recommend you check out. In fact, well, I'll come to this in a second. So here we have ant nests. And the ants and termites change the sort of size of the chambers inside of their nest depending on the temperature and humidity levels outside. And they change it in response to how the environment is changing. So that's why it's an adaptive computation. This is super interesting. This was recently discovered in the last year or two, a so-called termite nation in Brazil. This thing is as big as Rhode Island and supposedly 4,000 years old. So think about human society, and now think about what's going on out there in the world. We're not as impressive as we think. And you know, just to give you a sense of scale, this guy here, this is a termite mound behind him. Right? Okay, so some really great examples in nature. So another example comes from some work I do or have done on primate signaling circuits that compute power structures by encoding the collective view of who's capable of winning fights, the collective vote about who should be in charge. And I'm going to explain this in detail later, but for now, I just want to give you a sense of what this means. So down here, we have a female with a baby actually on her stomach. I'm not sure you can see that. And she's sort of bowing, and she's emitting what's called a pant grunt to this male. He's sort of tapping her on the head. And this is a subordination signal that she's giving him to tell him that she recognizes that he's better at winning fights than she is, and she accepts being subordinate in their social relationship for the time being. All right? And so, as you'll see later, and now males do this too. This isn't just females to males. And, you know, there's all sorts of interesting dynamics here. And the important thing is it's occurring outside the agonistic, outside the fight context. It's occurring in a peaceful setting. It's very important. We'll come back to that later. But the point is that everyone in the group is exchanging these signals. They're unidirectional. So if I give one to Albert, he's not going to give one back to me. It means I recognize he's stronger than I am, and I'm going to be subordinate for the time being. So they're exchanging these signals, and it results in the power structure. And I'll just give you a sense of what that means in a chimpanzee group. This video is it's a great video. I wish I could show you the whole thing. It comes from David Attenborough, I think in the 1970s. He made this video of wild chimps and chimps at a very famous colony in the Netherlands called Arnhem. And it just conveys chimpanzee behavior in the most sort of the best way that I've ever seen. Okay. It's just a snippet.
Always treat him with quite so much respect. Even though now he's reached the age of 17, Dandy wants to take his place among the great men, Nicky and Jerome. That's why he joins them. Though he prudently keeps a few paces behind them, and only goes a short way.
Okay. So these chimpanzees learn that they have this status in the group by virtue of this signaling network. All right. So primate signaling circuits compute power structure by encoding the collective vote. All right. Now, there's lots of great mechanistic work on the systems that I just described, and lots of great theoretical work as well, but most of it's specific to the particular study systems or ones that are closely similar, closely related. We don't yet have a sort of general theory for how biological systems compute, much less compute collectively. And it's worth noting two things at this point. The first is just a point of clarification, and that's when I talk about biological systems, I'm including social systems and human systems under that heading. That's the way I look at the world, and I think there's a lot of good reason for that. So just so you know, as we go through the talk, when I say biology, I mean society as well. All right. The second point is that like the systems that I just described, pretty much all of biology is collective. Almost all biological systems that I can think of are composed of components of individuals, whether they're cells or people or animals. There are many-bodied systems, and these components, these individuals, have only partly aligned interests. So that creates this interesting complexity. Now, I'm going to address the question of why compute before I tell you what collective computation is, because the reasons why we think biological systems compute turn out to be important for motivating the theory of collective computation that I'm going to develop in the second half of the talk. Okay. So we need to back out a little bit and start with some observations. So we're going to back all the way out to physics. All right. So physics is dominated by concepts like pressure, temperature, and entropy. You've heard about these in other lectures at the Santa Fe Institute. And these emerge through sort of simple collective interactions, and they give really deep insight into the behavior of the universe. And here we have a very simple sort of caricature of how physical systems like this work. So we've got the microscopic world with position, velocity, and mass. Those are sort of properties of the particles. And then the macroscopic world, pressure, volume, temperature, moles, and so forth. And the macroscopic world is like the world of thermodynamics, at, say, at equilibrium. And then statistical mechanics comes along, and the physicists show that you can derive these properties of the macroscopic world, these aggregate variables at equilibrium, from these microscopic things. All right, so just keep that in your head. Okay. We'll see it again. Okay. So biology makes use of comparable collective concepts, all right? Like, for example, some of the ones I work on, conflict management and robustness and metabolism. But in contrast to physics, these collective concepts are also functional. So that's one of the first important differences. All right. Now, these are some examples of more examples of biological systems. And just note that they're incredibly ordered looking. Lots of order and structure in biology. All right, so the next important point is that physics produces order through the minimization of energy. And biology produces order with the help of information processing, or with the addition of information processing. This is a very important point, and it's one of the key points in the talk. Okay, so why adaptive systems have this extra step of information processing, and whether it makes them fundamentally subjective and unamenable to laws and prediction, or at least fine prediction, are big open questions that many people in the history of the Santa Fe Institute have worked on. So I have a map here to illustrate these differences, a map for adaptive systems, and it's got a few extra features. So here's the macro, just like in the physical case. Here's the micro, as in the physical case. Well, now remember, we have multiple individuals interacting, producing that macro. But to do that, they're interrogating the environment. They're extracting regularities from the world around them. And that's influencing the strategies they use when they behave in their interactions. And it's from that that the macro is being generated. And then, as you're going to see during my talk today, that macro feeds back, so to speak, because the individuals at the microscopic level are making estimates of these macroscopic variables. So to make that more concrete, let's think of the chimpanzee example. So here are the macroscopic variables, the power structure. The individuals are constructing or making that power structure by virtue of those signaling interactions I told you about. And then once the power structure consolidates, we all know who's powerful. We can figure that out. We can look around and see who's signaling to each other. That feeds back and influences our decision making. So that's sort of the theme of the talk. We look at the environment. We extract regularities about who can win fights. We signal about that. From that, these social structures get created, and they feed back and change our behavior. OK. So before I move on, to summarize, two big differences between physical and adaptive systems are feedback and information processing in the adaptive case. And two more properties of biological systems that I'm going to talk about in just a second need to be mentioned to motivate the collective computation work I'll describe are complexity and error. Okay, so this is the picture of a cell that most of you probably remember from your grade school or junior high school textbooks. In fact, it probably was simpler at that time, but this is still pretty simple compared to what I'm about to show you. So we often think the lower levels are simpler than the higher levels. Humans are more complicated than the things in their bodies. Societies are more complicated than humans. Is this really right? Well, this is a picture of a cell. It doesn't seem so right to me. This is a typical cell in this is actually a neural cell. This is a very typical cell in an animal. You can see the nucleus, you've got the mitochondria, endoplasmic reticulum, and all of this stuff. There's no sort of liquidy cytoplasm around. Things are sort of freely floating. Right? I mean, there's some, but that's just not what's the dominant, you know, the dominant feature. Right? So complicated, complex. Right? Complicated and complex these things are. All right. Now, let's put this in context. It's even more amazing when you start thinking about this in context. This stuff, by the way, that image is from a book, textbook that's now available. I think it's probably very expensive. It's an amazing textbook. It's called Smart Biology, and it makes 3D animations of these things. So you can go online and look at their website and get a sense. Look at these things in 3D. I mean, I'd love to show you some other images of actually the behavior. Because the behavior when you look at it with the right lens looks just like the behavior of a city. It's unbelievably dramatic. I highly recommend looking up Smart Biology textbook and taking a look at some of these images. Okay, so let's put this in context. It's even more amazing when you put it in context. This incredibly complicated cell. This is, by the way, next to it is a prokaryotic cell. This one's E. coli. I think you might have heard about that in Lauren's talk last time around. And so, you know, we think of the human body and we think similarly like we did of our naive view of a cell. You know, there's a skeletal system, some muscle, a bunch of organs, we have a brain, right? Seems fairly straightforward. But now consider the fact that actually the human body is composed of 68 trillion cells. 30 trillion of which are so-called self cells, and 38 trillion of which are bacterial cells. Huge number, and most of them aren't ours. That's what the human is essentially, is a symbiont, a bacterial human symbiont. Okay, now consider the fact that 86 billion of those cells are in your brain. Now consider the fact that there are 8.6 million people in New York City. The naive take on this is that New York City is simple compared to the human body, if you just go based on numbers alone, and you take into account this complexity, so this is not trivial, right? Of course, if you can take a step back and maybe argue a kind of Russian doll approach to complexity, where you say, well, the higher levels include all the lower level stuff, so they're more complex for that reason alone. That's not so interesting to me. True, but I don't think that's interesting complexity. I think the point here is that our view of higher levels as being more complex than the lower ones is just wrong. And then it's complexity all the way down. But as I showed you in my previous slide, there's incredible order, incredible structure. So there's some simplification going on in this process. And that's what we're going to talk about today. All right, so error. So I only have one slide on error, even though it's a key message in my talk. There's lots of ways biological systems make errors, and one of the reasons is simply because they're so complex. Right? There's lots of ways things can go wrong. An important point to realize when I'm talking about error is what I mean by error is deviation from the theoretically maximum regularity that could be extracted from the environment. All right? So let's say you had a perfect information processor, and the environment's got some noise or chaos or whatever in it. What's the maximum amount of information you can get from that environment? That's, deviations from that are going to be what error is. And like I said, there are lots of ways that errors are made in biological systems. And I've got just one fun one. This is a human one here. Many of you probably know this example. It comes from the work of Christopher Chabri and Dan Simons. They're psychologists. And what they did is they made this experiment where they had people in white shirts passing a basketball, and they asked their subjects, and this has been done in many talks like this one, they asked their subjects to count how many times the ball was passed. And while this was happening, I'm sure a lot of you already know this, but while this was happening, a guy in a gorilla suit runs through the middle of the basketball game. And then they ask the people how many times the ball was passed. And no one says anything about the gorilla, and they sort of like come up with their number for how many times the ball was passed. No one sees the gorilla. If you haven't watched this video, and I'm sorry, I don't have time to actually show it to you today, it's really hard to believe. You know, you just don't want to believe that you wouldn't see the gorilla, but most people don't see it. And it's called a selective attention bias. And so there are many ways things can go wrong. Some of them are due to biases, and they're there for good reasons. They're there because there are trade-offs. We cannot pay attention to everything. And some of them are there because of failure. Parts break down over time. We all know this, aging, for example. Some of them are there because there's a scale mismatch. The thing in the environment that the regularity that's there to perceive is just too big for the system or too small. Right? So there's lots of ways that you can get errors. And what this ends up generating is what I'm going to call as a concept from physics, an effective theory. An effective theory is just, you can think of it as a theory that sort of works, maybe like a folk theory, but it's agnostic to mechanism. In other words, it could be wrong, but you still use it to make predictions, and it sometimes works. In physics, they usually mean it does work. Okay, so we're gonna worry about this case where we're going around, we're making these errors, we're creating this effective theory, each of us, for how the world works. And somehow, despite this, we're still getting these ordered states. How does that happen? All right, so some of you may anticipate where I'm going, and Albert mentioned it in his introduction. This sounds a little bit like collective intelligence, or the wisdom of crowds, which you've probably heard about in the popular literature. So I'll just say a quick word about that, in case you don't know what it is. So Francis Galton, back in 1907, was interested in this idea. And he said, in these democratic days, it's still relevant, any investigation of the trustworthiness and peculiarities of popular judgments is of interest. Now, he did an experiment, I think it was at a county fair or something, where he asked people in the crowd to estimate the weight of an ox or a steer. And the estimates ranged a lot. People were way off. But the average was actually really close to the actual weight of the steer. And this is called collective intelligence. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. It's basically the idea that we can overcome our individual biases and errors through the crowd by collecting our judgments and pooling them. And I'll just say quickly, Albert wrote a very nice paper with a couple other postdocs at SFI and another guy, Ian Cousin, who studies collective behavior, a couple of years ago that sort of expands on this idea and thinks about sort of more sophisticated mechanisms than just the average to make this even more correct. And that paper is published in the Royal Society. And if you're interested in this, it's an accessible paper. I would check it out. OK, so collective computation is related to this, but it's a little different. So the tenets of collective computation start with this idea that it's vital, and this is one of the most important points I'm going to make throughout this talk. It is absolutely vital in information processing systems to consider computation from the system's point of view. Okay? From the system's point of view. And that's because the subjectivity caused by complexity and error in information processing can be overcome, and this is the collective intelligence contribution, by computing collectively. And we're going to talk about how that happens. And our goal is to identify the algorithms and the circuits that the systems are using to do their computation. So as scientists, we're often looking down at a system, and we have a sort of model selection criterion, which means we're looking for a model with few parameters, a simple model that recovers the data. And that's our criteria for what's good. But we're adding here an additional criterion, and that is that the model has to be mechanistically legit. It has to actually, based on independent data, reflect how the system works, reflect its constraints, to take those things seriously. We want to understand how the system is doing the computation, not how we as scientists can make good predictions. Okay, so now I'll just quickly read this poem that's the sort of the conceptual anchor of the talk by Borges. Jorge Luis Borges is an Argentine writer, and I'm sure you all know him. He's so fabulous. So you will decide, or you can decide, the relationship of this to the talk. The second line in my title comes from this poem. Okay, so all things are words belonging to that language in which someone or something, night and day, writes down the infinite babble that is, per se, the history of the world. And in that hodgepodge, both Rome and Carthage, he and you and I, my life that I don't grasp, this painful load of being riddle, randomness, code, and all of Babel's gibberish stream by. Behind the name is that which has no name. Today I have felt its shadow gravitate, in this blue needle its trembling sweep, casting its influence toward the furthest strait, with something of a clock glimpsed in a dream and something of a bird that stirs in its sleep. All right. Yeah. Another point of the poems in the talk is I go very fast, as you may have noticed. And the poems sort of slow down the thoughts a little bit for me and hopefully for you. Okay. So what am I saying here? Am I saying that life, society, financial markets, that they're computers like this? No, I'm not saying anything like that. And to sort of understand what I am saying, we do need to go to computer science for a few minutes. Before we do that, I just want to point out that the way scientists approach, or those of us who work on computation, approach it in biology or in nature, can be sort of classified into five categories. One is methodologically, and this is not interesting at all, and it's the dominant one. And so you hear about systems biology or computational biology. It's just methods people use. They're using more or less a computer to simulate stuff. It doesn't have anything to do really with what I'm saying. But when you hear computational biology, that's what people mean. Okay, the next is metaphorically. So, you know, the brain is a computer, and maybe I get a little bit of creative ideas about how to approach my questions based on that idea, but I don't really think about it deeply. All right, and a metaphor, you know, has its uses, so I don't want to be too dismissive there, but we're not talking about metaphors tonight. All right, pragmatically. The pragmatic folks, they're deeply interested in the system they study. Maybe it's a gene regulatory circuit like I described at the beginning of my talk. And they want to do whatever it takes to understand that system. So they're going to import concepts from maybe physics and computer science, like circuits and gates and so forth, to make better models. But they're not interested in the foundations of computation. And that's fine. They're interested in how their system works, and that's great. It's a noble pursuit, but it's a different pursuit than the one we're after here. Then there are the foundational types, and they go to computer science, and they want the key core concepts in computer science. They're going to ask, can we fit biology into them? Can we use them to structure how we think about biological problems? We're going to come back to that in a minute. And then there are the people like me, and this is a glib term in a way, but it's sort of the way I think about this, who are pragmatically foundational. The pragmatic foundational people are interested in deep ideas about computation in nature and unifying ideas about how systems compute from, you know, gene circuits up to chimpanzees encoding the power structure in a collective vote in a circuit. But recognize that the computer science way of doing things is probably not right for biology. And so we're going to borrow concepts and modify them that get us somewhere. But we are after foundations for biology. And then maybe down the road, when we have some idea of what those are, we can compare them with the ones in computer science and come up with an even deeper theory that satisfies both. OK. So this is a little bit, this is going to be a few minutes on this topic. And you have to just bear with me as I go through a few complicated ideas. Here we have on the screen, who's on the screen? Turing, Church, and von Neumann. All right? Yes, so the sort of gods of computer science. And there's others I could include, I could have put up here too, but with respect to my talk, these are the most important ones. Okay. So within computer science, there are many types of computation, and we all sort of know this. Including things like algorithmic, distributed computation, analog, among others. And sort of the distinctions, as far as I can tell, among these different kinds of computation are a little bit blurry, you know, but they're interesting. And by algorithmic computation, we typically mean something like the following. A program implements an algorithm that acts on some input to produce an output. All right, so you're all with me so far. And the program implements an algorithm that acts on an input to produce an output. And the program halts or terminates when the correct output is produced. That's what's called a termination criterion. All right, so the algorithm is a recipe or a set of steps, discrete steps, that are followed to produce a desired output. And this discreteness sort of distinguishes algorithmic computation from a broader class of explanations for input-output maps that we might generally call models. Analog computation, for example, falls into this larger space. And it can be implemented with a circuit of connections that perform different functions depending on how it's wired. All right? So it's just current flowing over the circuit, no discreteness. Now, returning to algorithmic computation, additional criteria beyond discreteness that are typically implied when we talk about this concept derive in part from the way the field of computer science developed. I'm not a computer scientist. I may be provoking some of you in the audience, and that's fine. We can talk about it later. But by the way, these ideas that I'm going to be relaying to you, I really am grateful to this guy, Jack Copeland, who's written some very nice essays on this history, some of which you can find in the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy. And if you're interested, I recommend you take a look at his papers. OK, so I'm suggesting that some of the ideas about algorithmic computation developed as a consequence of the history of how computer science developed. OK, so for example, the concept of algorithm was popularized when the mathematician David Hilbert at the turn of the century, the turn of the 20th century, challenged the community to provide an effective method or set of steps for deciding whether, this is a detail, but whether a polynomial had roots made up solely of integers. OK, so the point is effective method. So the idea of an effective method resulted in the insight that some mathematical problems might be what's called non-decidable. Meaning there's no set of steps that one can use to reliably solve them. However, it was very hard to prove this. It's kind of an intuition. Very hard to prove this intuition because the concept of algorithm had no formal basis. And that's where Church and Turing come in. So Church and Turing set out independently to provide a formal mathematical basis for the concept of algorithm. All right, and so Church developed what was called the lambda calculus. Turing developed the Turing machine. I won't say too much about those tonight, except they're both mathematical constructs, and they provide a principled language for evaluating a claim that there exists an algorithm that would always give the right answer to a particular mathematical problem. So you see, this definition of algorithm is sitting in this particular space. Now, although the formal definition of algorithm is something that can be implemented by a Turing machine, it has come to kind of dominate the idea in computer science. The definition, in my view, and again, here's where I'm being a little provocative, is not so much foundational as pragmatic. The Church-Turing thesis, as far as I'm concerned, simply allows one to say that a computation is decidable. Simply, I don't mean to be dismissive. All right, so the definition of a computable function is a little bit more encompassing. It includes any function that can be computed, whether a Turing machine or something else. And a computer is any device that runs programs solving computable functions. All right, so this is a little bit of background on these concepts in computer science. So now, when I mentioned there are biologists who want to go to computer science and make the foundations of computation and biology sort of derived from the theoretical foundations in computer science, they're the ones who are asking questions like, is the brain a Turing machine? Is the brain a universal computer? What are its limits in terms of what it can produce? These are very much in that tradition, these questions. And to make that a sensible question, you have to specify some model of computation underlying this process, like a Turing machine, and then prove that the brain can solve this set of computable functions defined by this model of computation. This is a very hard problem in biology for lots of reasons, mostly having to do with the fact there are all sorts of constraints that make it difficult. There have been some successes, and one example is in a paper recently published by one of our external faculty, I believe, Juan Perez Mercader, and I apologize, Juan, if I've mispronounced your last name. He's a friend of mine. I actually don't know how to pronounce his name. It's terrible. I was looking it up today, but I couldn't find any help. So what he did is he and his collaborators showed that a simple one-pot chemical reactor, and I'm not going to go into any details about this, a simple one-pot chemical reactor could recognize context-sensitive grammars, which is a criteria, or they use as a criteria to say that this is a Turing machine. And the reason why this is important is because this says that at the origin of life, and in phenomena like that, you don't need complex biochemistry to do complex computations. So there's power in this approach, but it's not really well-suited, I would argue, to biology. So that's why I'm not in that foundational camp, and I'm in the pragmatically foundational one. Furthermore, to say a function is computable because it can be solved with an algorithm implemented by a Turing machine is a mathematical statement. And this is a subtle point, but it's important to what I'm going to say later. The steps are mathematical steps. All right? So another way of saying this is that there are, you know, many functions that can be solved algorithmically, but they can also be stated in the language of dynamical systems. There's a kind of isomorphism. But some mathematical approaches lend better to thinking about some problems, and others lend better to thinking about others. You can think about, as a simple case, Arabic versus Roman numerals, right? They're the same thing, but they're differently useful, okay? So the choice of mathematical representation is sometimes more about expedience than it is about correctness. That's my take. Now, if our goal is to understand how biological systems perform computations, we need not just this mathematical understanding, which is very important, but we also need an understanding of mechanics, because biological computation is instantiated in material. And we need to understand how that material affects the computation. So Walter Fontana used to be faculty at the Institute and has had a lot of influence on my thinking over the years. And Leo Buss sought to bridge this divide a long time ago by arguing that a formal model of computation needs to take mechanisms seriously. And at that time, I wouldn't say much about this, but they're thinking about chemical systems. And they wanted a formal model of computation that was based on chemical action. So this is starting to bridge that divide, that sort of foundational to pragmatically foundational divide. And they called this the pi calculus, or eventually became the pi calculus, which some of you may have heard about in talks in the past. Now, my sort of pragmatically foundational take on this is that we need a taxonomy of mechanism and an understanding of the mechanical process, mechanical principles, before moving towards an underlying formal theory of computation for biology. All right? So my current and future work is largely concerned with elucidating the mechanics of collective computation, looking for principles that apply in a variety of different biological systems. Kinds of questions that interest me are, how are computations refined over evolutionary time and learning time? Do they get better? Are they better able to, for example, recover features of the environment? If there are universal computers in nature, presumably they started more simply. How did they get there? Okay. All right. So now, to sort of juxtapose biology and computer science in this sort of pragmatically foundational view, this is my sociological poem. It's from Yeats. And I found it a couple days ago, actually. I hadn't read it before. In this very nice essay written by this guy, Marco Roth, who in N plus one magazine, in case you've heard of that, it was one of the best essays I've read on a remembrance of Harold Bloom, who's a literary critic who died recently. And there have been tons of essays written about him. This was a really great essay. And in it, he quotes this excerpt from a stanza of one of Yeats' poems. And the reason he chooses it is because he said it had a huge influence on Harold Bloom, and in particular on his famous work, The Anxiety of Influence. So hopefully you see the sort of like tangential connection to my computer science biology thing. So the poem, this excerpt goes like this. I call to the mysterious one who yet shall walk the wet sands by the edge of the stream and look most like me, being indeed my double, and prove, of all imaginable things, the most unlike being my anti-self, and standing by these characters disclose all that I seek. So Roth's hypothesis was that this poem, and he may have known it from somewhere, had a huge influence on Harold Bloom. And it's the context for my objection to too much reliance on the foundations of computer science. Okay. Okay, so questions now. So now that these ideas about computer science are on the table and biology, I think that we can sort of carve up the space of questions in biology about computation into these categories, what I'll call capacity, mechanics and architecture, efficiency and optimality, and evolution. Capacity is that question of, like, is the brain a universal computer? It's the sort of more standard foundational computer science take. What range of gene expression patterns or phenotypic traits can a gene regulatory network compute? What's possible? Is the brain a universal computer? The mechanistic architecture category captures questions like, does the logic of the circuit make sense? Do we want a decentralized computation, or do we have nodes in the circuit, you know, components of the circuit that play an undue causal influence on the output? What's the role of robustness? Are the dynamics, the collective dynamics, non-trivial? Meaning, can you decompose the components in the circuit into individual units, or do they form groups that are really cohesive and can't be broken down further? These are canonical collective behavior questions. All right, this is close, if you're familiar with these ideas in neuroscience, computation in neuroscience, to close but not at all identical to David Marr's idea about the sort of levels and types of questions we might ask in neural systems. And he had the computational, algorithmic, and implementational. I think that was very useful at the time. I don't think it's useful anymore. And it's just an aside for those of you who are familiar with this discussion. I like to think in terms of mechanics and architecture. I think it's more broad. And then my third category is efficiency and optimality. And there we're asking, does the computation efficiently and robustly produce an optimal output? Does it overcome those errors to produce optimal extraction of regularities from the environment? And by the way, again, as an aside, there are some biological systems that optimally process information, and some great work has been done on these systems by a physicist at Princeton called Bill Bialik and his collaborators. And if you're familiar with the magazine Quantum Magazine, which is an outstanding science magazine, there's a great essay in there recently, you can just Google it, about Bill and his work on optimal information processing. Okay, accessible essay. All right, and the final question is about evolution, and there are the sort of issues are, are some circuits or some computations more evolvable than others? So this is, for me, the sort of basic set of questions that we might ask and how they sort of divide up. Most of my work focuses on mechanics and architecture. All right, so now we're going to, being pragmatically foundational, we're going to actually borrow some of those computer science concepts, and we're going to modify them as needed. And this is at quite a high level. So we're going to borrow the notion of an architecture. And what I have here on the screen is the von Neumann architecture, and the details don't really matter. I mean, it's interesting to know that your computer is based on this. It's a sort of dominant architecture. And we're gonna try and devise an architecture for collective computation where there's some elements, and the architecture specifies the interaction of the elements, the sort of the arrangement of things, so that you get this reliable output from this input. We're gonna borrow the concept of algorithm, and I, of course, talked quite a bit about that already. And I'll just make it more concrete by giving this example of the notoriously bad bubble sort algorithm. Bubble sort is just the way you might order words in a list. It's very slow. That's why it's notoriously bad. So to make this more concrete, there's some input, words in a list or an array. There's output, the ordered list. There's the algorithm, repeatedly stepping through the list to be sorted, comparing adjacent items, and swapping if they're in the wrong order. So that's that set of steps I talked about earlier. Termination criterion here is just that the output must be in non-decreasing order. Remember, that's how you know this is correct, that the algorithm is performed correctly, such that each element is no smaller than the previous element according to the desired total order, and the output is reordering of the input. So that's, we're going to borrow that notion of an algorithm. We're going to borrow the notion of a circuit, and I'm going to talk more about this in just a minute. But basically, here we have a circuit where you can see the circuit has two behaviors. The light bulb's on or it's off. Some current flows over the circuit, and then depending, there's a capacitor or a battery over here, and then depending on whether the gates are open or closed, the system's in one state or the other. Right? Okay. So now we're going to go through an example of collective computation, a real example from a monkey group. And I'm using the monkeys to make this point because they're easy for us to get our heads around. It's much harder to get your heads around, to get your head around a cellular system or a neural system where the language might be unfamiliar. But the monkeys, they behave like us for the most part, so it's a little easier. Okay. So this is a pigtailed macaque. It's a great photograph. You can see so much on that face. All right. I worked with these guys for a long time. And we're going to talk about collective computation and power structure, which I mentioned in the context of the chimpanzees at the start of this presentation. So the monkeys, these monkeys that I studied, lived in a large compound at Yerkes National Primate Center in Georgia. And they have lots of fights. They also do lots of friendly stuff. And the fights sometimes are serious, and sometimes, most of the time, they're not. They're just little spats. And there are about 80 animals in this group, 50 of which were adults. And the fights actually varied quite a bit in size, from just me and Albert, two people, to like 30 of us. And the fights, there was never like all at once. It's generally sequential. So Albert and I have a fight. Albert redirects to Tim. Tim redirects to me. Maybe Laura joins in and so forth. Maybe Tim drops off after a while. So we've got this sequence. All right, so this is what a small fight looks like. And it's basically one juvenile and an adult female having some bidirectional aggression. This third juvenile joins in on behalf of the first. So it's a triadic interaction. And I don't think you can see it in this video, but after the fight is over, there's actually a reconciliation. So there's more than 400 species of animals that have been demonstrated to repair their relationships after fights. That's just not a human capacity. The animals do it too. Primates in particular. Okay, so fights, like I said, they can be serious. And this female here, she was notoriously bad and aggressive female, and one day she got it good, and her nose was destroyed in a conflict. And sometimes these conflicts result in the death of animals. They often result in these kinds of serious injuries. So they're to be taken seriously. And so the monkeys, the monkeys need to learn something. They need to learn their underlying differences in fighting ability. They can't see those. They have to infer them based on the outcome of the fights. And it is worth their time to learn who can beat up whom for this reason, right? So the monkeys have fights with each other. Albert and I have a history of fights, a long time series of fights. And over the course of that time series, Albert and I learn the who's going to win, the probability of who's going to win, and we learn the magnitude of the asymmetry. And once, let's say I've learned that I'm likely to lose, once I've learned I'm likely to lose in this species of monkey, I'm going to send or emit this subordination signal. In the chimpanzees I mentioned, it was a pant grunt. In these macaques, it's called a silent bare teeth display. It's like a smile. And I'm going to do this in a peaceful setting so Albert knows I'm not just agreeing to give up during the fight, I'm actually saying I will be subordinate in this relationship for the time being. Okay? So the monkeys are essentially looking at their time series of fights with each other, and they're taking an average. They're estimating sort of like average likelihood of who's going to lose. Right? Now, lots of factors influence the outcome of fights, so this is not necessarily easy to estimate. Some days, maybe it's raining and I slip in a puddle, or maybe I'm not feeling well today, or maybe my fair weather coalition partners are not present today. all right? But maybe tomorrow my alliance partners, the ones who are always going to help me out, maybe they're in the compound, right? Or maybe Albert had food poisoning this morning or whatever, right? So there are lots of reasons why the outcomes of fights fluctuate that have nothing to do with who's the stronger animal. So luck and skill or noise have a big impact on the outcome of these fights. So the challenge for the monkeys is, despite that luck, despite chance, to figure out who's the better fighter. And so Emily Dickinson, one of my favorite poets, has a lovely short poem on this topic. Luck is not chance, it's toil. Fortune's expensive smile is earned. The father of the mine is that old-fashioned coin we spurned. All right, so I'm going to introduce a new term, coarse-grained. So subordination signals are coarse-grained representations of fight history and change slowly compared to fight outcomes. So once I've learned that Albert is going to beat me up in these fights, I'm going to give him that subordination signal, and I'm going to do it like every couple of weeks. I'm going to give him one. And we're still fighting. We're fighting at a somewhat lower frequency because we now have this friendlier relationship by virtue of me having agreed to this status. But we still have to keep the fights going because we still want to make sure nothing's changed to make me the better fighter. All right? So we keep the fights going, but now I have to have a lot more fights, a longer time series before I realize that actually I've become the better fighter. Right? So the signals, those SBTs I talked about, the silent pair of teeth display, they're a coarse-grained representation of fight dynamics. We're going to come back to that term in just a second. It sort of summarizes the state of the relationship. And they change slowly compared to the fast fights. And this is just a nice schematic I have illustrating a female giving that signal to a male in a peaceful setting. So she's sitting here foraging. This is the male. She slowly gets up. She approaches him. She looks in his face so he sees the signal. She's right in front of him. You can see the signal here. She does a few other things. And then she sits down and they go back to foraging together. Okay, so coarse graining. It's a concept from physics, and it's one of the most important concepts in my work. It's basically the idea that we're emphasizing the regularities or the essence of something, not the details. So as you remember with the fight history, there's lots of contextually variable factors like how I'm feeling today, whether my alliance partners or my fair weather friends are there, and so forth, that might influence those fight outcomes. So what we want is the essence of the asymmetry, the essence of the regularity in the relationship. And just to make that more concrete, you know, pointillism in painting is a great example of coarse graining. And here is a sequence by Mondrian of the famous trees, where we have a fair bit of detail here and quite a bit of abstraction here. So coarse graining, different degrees of coarse graining. Okay. So now everyone in the group is exchanging these signals, as I told you about with the chimps. And the subordination signaling circuit is forming as the individuals are exchanging these signals. So I've got a version of that illustrated here. So this individual eight is receiving signals from a lot of other group members. So that means that a lot of other group members have learned that number eight, there can successfully win fights. Right? And what we're essentially interested in is that collective view. What's the collective view in the group about any individual's capacity to use force? That's going to be our definition of power. Individuals, remember that the conflicts in these systems, the fights that I showed you, are often involve multiple individuals. So what matters, if you're going to intervene in the fight, for example, is how the group perceives you. Not how one individual perceives you or how you're perceived in pairwise, but what the consensus is in the group about your capability to win this fight. And so this is a general theme in collective computation. What's the consensus view, the collective view in the system about what the regularities in the environment are? In this case, about some individual's fighting ability. So we have this circuit of these things, and then we can apply algorithms to it, and we're, of course, interested in the kind of algorithms the system is using to do this computation, algorithms that measure that consensus and give for each individual a score that says how much agreement there is in the group that this individual can use force successfully. All right? So there are different ways we look at a lot of different formalisms or algorithms that might be operating in this group to produce a distribution of power. And the way we do this is we ask, if we test these different algorithms that we think are reasonable given what we understand about monkeys' cognition, and we ask, does it generate a distribution of power that predicts behavior in the system it should predict if it's really capturing power? Right? So for example, if it's really capturing power, it should predict who's often requested by animals that are fighting to intervene and provide support. It should predict who pays no cost when they intervene. All right, so variables like that. And so one algorithm, I'll just tell you about one of the sort of more straightforward ones that we study is takes into account the total number of signalers, the total number of individuals in the group who give me one of these silent bear teeth displays, and it takes into account the diversity of my population of senders. So, for example, if at the end of this talk, one of you came up to me and said 100 times that my talk was bad, that wouldn't be very useful. But if 100 of you said that to me, that would be informative. Okay? So the algorithm that I'm just describing takes that into account. It takes into account the total frequency I get and the sort of diversity. And from that, we get a score for every individual, and then we get a power distribution. And it turns out that in this system, power is distributed such that more or less everyone has basically the same amount. And there's a few individuals who are out in the tail of the distribution, a few individuals who are perceived by the group to be disproportionately powerful, an order of magnitude or a couple order of magnitude more powerful than the rest of the individuals. And this makes possible, so there's two things going on here. One, knowing the animals are trying to compute their power distribution, their power scores. They're not necessarily doing it consciously. I'll come back to that in a second. And they're using that information to estimate their cost they're going to pay in social interaction. Because if they're perceived to be powerful, they're not going to pay much of a cost. And so it turns out in this system that there's a few individuals out there in the tail who everyone thinks are just so powerful. And these individuals, when they intervene in fights, they don't pay any cost. They pay, it's negligible. No one ever challenges them. And as a consequence of this, they can engage in behaviors that, because they're intrinsically costly, but now are no longer costly for these individuals, that weren't possible before. And one of the behaviors that becomes possible when you have a distribution like this, so it's actually the sort of good side of inequality, if you like, is this policing behavior. And the policing behavior is these powerful individuals actually break up fights among group members. Right? So this new kind of conflict management, this new function for the system that wasn't accessible when the distribution didn't have this heavy long tail, becomes accessible because the cost of behavior has changed. Keep that in mind. We're going to come back to that later. Okay, so how does this translate into what I was saying at the beginning of the talk in terms of this map? So this is what we're going to talk about for the next couple slides, and then I'm done. And this part of the talk is a little bit more abstract. We're going to go slowly. But you now have the pieces you need to understand there's no math or anything, the abstractions I'm going to present. All right? So as I said, in the adaptive system case, we've got the X's, the components, the monkeys, and they're making estimates of the environment. And the environment here is the fight outcomes, which they're trying to use to infer the sort of skill, fighting skill of the monkeys that they can't actually see directly. And then they're, through the signals that they use to indicate what they understand about that, those subordination signals or the pant grunts in the case of the chimpanzees, there's a circuit of these signals being exchanged. And encoded in that circuit is information about the power structure. That's our macroscopic variable, as it's called. So property of social structure. And then it feeds back by modulating the cost of social interaction to change how the X's behave. All right, so now here is our model, our working model for collective computation, our collective computation architecture, if you like. And I'm going to go through it first in the abstract, and then we're going to work through it again with the monkey example to make it clear. Okay, so the W's are distribution of environmental states. Basically captures the state of the world. And this is something I didn't mention, but some of you might have picked up on this distinction. It can be exogenous ground truth. By that, it's like jargon. By that, I mean something like the Eiffel Tower. It's outside the control of the system. It's not something that you and I can change the height of, right? It's outside the control of the system. And we have a measurement device that we more or less agree will tell us the right height. Now, for the philosophers in the room, I realize that ground truth is tricky, but what we're going to get to next is much trickier. So we're going to just not worry about that aspect of this for the moment. We're going to say that the Eiffel Tower is one kind of thing we might want to estimate outside the control of the system, agreed measurement device. And then there's this other thing, which I'm going to call an endogenous effective ground truth. And what that means is, think about like an institution like Harvard or the power structure in the monkey case. These are things that are built by the system through the collective dynamics in the system. So that in case of Harvard, 400 years old or whatever it is, built over a long period of time, very hard for us as actors in the system to change anything about it. Very hard for the monkeys to really individually change anything about the power structure. These things have slow time scales, but they're part of the system. They're endogenous. They become a kind of effective ground truth like the Eiffel Tower when it's hard to change them and they have that slow time scale. And a lot of the things, so when the heading of my talk, the collective computation of reality in nature and society, is partly about computing things like the height of the Eiffel Tower. And a lot of the stuff I work on is about computing these endogenous things that take on these slow time scales and are hard to change. I'm going to come back to that point in a second again. Okay, so the X here corresponds to the circuit that's composed of what we might call opinions or strategies about how the world works that the sensors of the individuals in the system, the monkeys, for example, have about the W's, about the regularities in the environment. The Y's are simple or complex aggregations of X. And so if you remember when I mentioned collective intelligence, I mentioned Galton taking the average. That would be an example of a simple aggregation. It's a very simple computation compared to some of the algorithms that we use to measure consensus in the circuit about power, for example. And the Y's correspond to those macroscopic variables, social structure, or you know, in the physics case, it was like temperature, and entropy, and so forth, right? The features of the higher aspects of the system. Okay. The Z's are behavioral outputs, changes to the system dynamics in some sense, that are made possible by those Y's, by the construction of those macroscopic variables that hopefully recover something about the W's. Right. The P's are algorithms, the algorithms that the X's use to estimate the regularities in the environment. And the A here is the algorithm, like I talked about, the monkey case, that takes us from the circuit to the distribution of power. And B is how the distribution of power, by say changing the cost of social interaction, changes the behaviors that I can perform. Because my uncertainty about the world has been reduced now that I know what the cost of social interaction will be for a given behavior. All right? So this is our architecture for collective computation. And now I've got just a few principles and then I'll be done. So the first principle is this distinction between individual and collective encoding. So what that means is we want to know whether the power structure, for example, is largely a consequence of the collective dynamics, the signaling dynamics among the monkeys, or is largely a consequence of the actual fighting ability of the individual monkeys. So if it's collectively encoded, if it's generated, if it's like the information is in the network or in the circuit, as opposed to in individuals. Right? And one of the ways we can study this is to ask what the correlation is between the social structure, power structure, the macroscopic variable, and the environmental state, and how that compares to, say, the correlation between the X's opinions, the distribution of opinions, and the environmental state. And I say correlation, and to do this, we use mutual information or information theoretic concepts, which are like correlations. Okay, but more powerful. All right. So I won't read the compass again, but it's relevant at this point. So just a little more information for you to sort of triangulate with. Okay, my second point, accumulation versus aggregation. So you probably have, you know, if you're investors, for example, you've heard a little bit about behavioral economics maybe and how humans have all these biases and overconfidence, for example. And this comes back to my point about error that I made in the beginning of the talk or the selective attention. In the gorilla experiment. So we have all these errors that we as individuals tend to make. And so, you know, as I said earlier, the collective computing is a kind of solution to the subjectivity those errors introduce. Now, the X is making estimates of the regularities in the environment with all those errors. This is what we call information accumulation. In neuroscience, it's sometimes called evidence accumulation. So the sensors or the individuals going out and collecting information about the world is information accumulation. Information aggregation is finding a way to combine all those strategies or opinions to produce the Y's, right? The algorithms that we use to get the collective view in the network and the circuit. Now, once you have this concept of information accumulation, information aggregation, you can start thinking about how these might trade off against each other. So in some of our work, we found they have different time scales. The information accumulation might have a long time scale. You let the sensors of the individuals go out and collect information for quite a long period of time before they come back and share it. Or the aggregation mechanism could have a long time scale, right? And maybe that makes it easier to actually compute a reliable power structure that relates to the Ws. So one question you might ask is, if you know your individuals, your sensors, make lots of errors, can we compensate for those errors by building aggregation mechanisms that maybe weight different individual contributions to the collective output differently? So let's say your individuals, the naive individuals, make lots of errors, and you have a few experts in your group. So maybe your algorithm will weight the opinions of those experts or the strategies they use more heavily than the ones of the naive users. So the principle of information accumulation versus aggregation is an error correction mechanism, and it's a way of, given the limitations in your system, of balancing this trade-off and getting a better collective output. All right. So I talked a lot about coarse graining. I didn't yet introduce this term hierarchy of timescales, but I alluded to it in the sense that the fight dynamics in the monkey case, right, change fast. I said that. They're changing a lot every day. The opinions the monkeys have, the signals they send to sum up their view of those fight dynamics, the silent bare teeth display and the pan crunch, I said they are given every couple of weeks. They have a slower time scale than the fight dynamics. They're a coarse-grained variable that summarizes how the monkeys see those regularities. And as a summary, they provide information to, the senders giving the signal to the receiver, that reduces the receiver's uncertainty about how the sender is going to behave tomorrow or the next day. So this is a very important concept, uncertainty reduction. So what I've been talking about in this last section of the talk is very much about this concept of uncertainty reduction. The coarse-grained variables reduce uncertainty about the future, and that's why they're so useful. Now, it's not just one slower time scale. We have a second slower time scale. The power structure changes more slowly than the signals. The signals change on the order of weeks, or they're given on the order of weeks, and it may take many fights for them to change. In order for the power distribution to change, many signals in the circuit have to switch direction. It takes a long time for that to happen. So the power structure is an even more reliable predictor or reducer of uncertainty. Now, of course, the challenge here is that the power distribution and the collective dynamics producing it have to accurately capture, to some extent, the underlying distribution of fighting abilities. There has to be information in that power distribution about this. Otherwise, as an institution or social structure, it ceases to be good for anything. Okay? All right. So I said in the monkey case that having this uncertainty reduction about the cost I'm going to pay during social interactions by virtue of the power structure allows new behavior to emerge in the system. It allows this new conflict management behavior, the policing. So what happens is we get these Zs, this new set of Zs that are feeding back, that are a result of the Ys feeding back on the Xs. We're getting a behavioral expansion in the system because of the uncertainty reduction. Now, in my abstract, if you read that, I made the provocative statement that the complex systems mantra, the sort of Santa Fe Institute mantra in some sense, there's actually many versions of this, so I'm not entirely being fair, that complexity emerges from interactions among simple components is wrong. And I truly believe that it is wrong. And the reason I believe it's wrong is because what happens, what I just described to you, is complexity at the microscopic scale. Think about those cells in the beginning of my talk. Think about all the variables affecting the fight dynamics, all that noise and chance and luck in there, plus the skill. There's a lot of complexity there. Then there's this coarse graining. The coarse graining that gives you the signals, the coarse graining of the circuit that gives you the power distribution. The coarse graining is a simplification, all right? The coarse graining is a simplification, so we get this bottleneck, and this is a term I borrowed from Naftali Tishbe, and he uses it in information theoretic sense in the context of artificial intelligence and some other things to sort of describe exactly this. It's a compression that happens here. And then, as a consequence of that, when it works well, and I didn't have too much time to talk about when it doesn't work well tonight, we get this expansion of behavior, the policing, the new function. And so what I think is the right way to think about micro to macro in complex systems is as this hourglass, where you have complexity at the lower levels and complexity at the higher levels, but at the mesoscopic scale, you get this dimension reduction or the simplification or information bottleneck through which the micro is passing to give you this behavioral expansion here. And I think there are people, I think Murray, Gell-Mann certainly might have agreed with this way of thinking about things. I think he more or less stated it this way. But it's quite a bit different from what I typically see in the literature, where the assumption is that the lower levels are simpler and there's these simple interactions among the components. And somehow out of this, and there are examples, you get these complex patterns at the aggregate level. So my last slide. Computing device versus computation. So in the work that I've been describing, in Computation in Nature, I've emphasized taking into account the systems point of view. So the components, the cells, the monkeys, humans, they're making estimates of those macroscopic variables they're constructing, like the power structure. And they're changing their behavior as a result. And this feedback is something that I've called effective downward causation in some of my papers, is critically important to making this not just about computers, but about computation. This is why I feel that I'm entitled to talk about these systems as performing computations, because there are agents, there's a computation for, and I'll come to that, what I mean by that in a second. There are agents in the system who are using the computation to do work. All right, now this point, which you can read about in a paper I wrote called Coarse Graining as a Downward Causation Mechanism, and it's pretty accessible paper, was also made in a different way a couple of years ago by Claire Horsman, and I have to thank Walter Fontana for finding this paper, who asked this question, when does a physical system compute? And Horsman is making this point for physical systems like computers, like traditional computers, that you are not entitled to say that these things are doing computations unless there's a legitimate concept of computation for, some kind of agency in the system. And what we often forget, I think in computer science, and maybe I'm being a little unfair here, but I think this is true, maybe not for people like Alan Kay, but for the most part in computer science, we forget about this part, the human part, makes the computation. Okay. So the final thing, my final slide, is a poem from our very own D.H. Lawrence, who wrote this poem before the Santa Fe Institute was founded in the 80s. And I think it's great. It's called The Third Thing. Water is H2O, hydrogen two parts, oxygen one. But there's also a third thing that makes it water, and nobody knows what it is. The atom locks up two energies, but it's a third thing present which makes it an atom. All right, thank you.
Do we have any questions?
I'm curious, your bottleneck is very similar to the conundrum of our vision systems. In other words, our eyes are very complex, but our optic nerve is a bottleneck, and yet the system works. Do you see that parallel?
Well, I don't know the details of that system well enough to say for sure, but certainly there are filters. Our sensory organs have filters that prioritize certain kinds of information over others, and that is roughly analogous to the bottleneck I'm describing. It's to see the important thing, the essence. Any other questions?
Do you think this would be helpful to teach diplomats, or it could be used in diplomacy? I mean, for example, would it work with monkeys like Putin and Trump?
So I heard the last part of that question, but I missed the first part. I think that might have been the really important part.
Not important at all. Would this be helpful to teach diplomats, or could it be used in diplomatic behavior?
I still can't hear. I'm sorry. I don't hear very well. Can someone else repeat the question, maybe?
Can
it be used for diplomacy?
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. I used to think a lot about power, And you know, the ideas about power that I was writing about were actually developed in sociology, and the most important influence on that work was a sociologist called Bierstadt. And I'm very interested in the idea at that time that when you use power, you risk losing it. And so I often would think about people like Saddam Hussein and these more punitive regimes of Putin's and so forth, and what that says about power. Like, are these guys in danger of losing their status? And if not, what are the additional mechanisms in the system that prevent them every time they use force from being challenged and risking losing it? And so I think there are implications for diplomacy and things like that hidden in here, but they're not things I've thought about in a long time, other than, you know, this fairly profound idea that when you exercise your power, you risk losing it. So the macaques that sit in the tail of that power distribution, they don't use force when they intervene. They intervene peacefully for the most part. They only use force when they really need it.
Do we have any more questions? Oh, Alana, there's one.
So you mentioned that through observing the signaling and making kind of a generalized, as you said, like pragmatic version of computation, that you've come across kind of like this bottleneck model for what computation could be more generally. Do you feel like there's a more even general computation model than that that you're kind of working towards?
So let's see. I think there are maybe two different approaches to this question. The first is to say that I didn't say much about the algorithms the animals used to estimate, or cells, neurons, used to estimate regularities in their environment. But this is a vast area of research, mostly in computational neuroscience, where the focus is on whether brains are Bayesian or not, and so forth. And so there's a lot of work there to be integrated to better understand how what are the different models and algorithms being used to estimate these regularities. The sort of second point to your question, the sort of deeper point, I think, is, as I stressed, right now we're working on a kind of taxonomy of mechanism, understanding the mechanics of collective computation in a lot of different kinds of systems. And after we have this in place, this is my personal bias, then I think we can start thinking about underlying formal models of computation, Turing-like or not. And this is kind of a Walter's point when he was developing this sort of formal model of computation that took seriously chemical action. And what he was after when he was building the Pi calculus with his collaborators was a formal language for speaking about how these systems work that takes seriously mechanism. And I think that is where we're going. And in that sense, it's much more general than what I described. Right? So what I'm talking about, even if the mechanisms and the principles like accumulation versus aggregation, coarse gradient, hierarchy of timescales, even if they apply broadly across systems, which I fully believe they do, we're still not at the sense that we don't really understand. We have to be able to answer that capacity question, for example. You know, we want something deeper. And as far as I'm concerned, that's a long way off, but we're, you know, heading there.
Another question?
I wanted to, is this thing working? Oh, there it goes. I wanted to ask about the structure in the human brain. I understand that the subconscious can process information 5,000 times faster than the conscious brain, which has filters. That's an oversimplification. How does that fit into what the monkeys are actually perceiving?
Yeah, so that question brings up an issue I wanted to mention in my talk, but I forgot or really didn't have time. And that is, I said, for example, that the monkeys are computing their power scores. They're looking over the network, they're taking into account the number of signalers, maybe the diversity of their population of signalers. It's a complex computation. And not only are they doing it for themselves, but they're actually looking at everyone else signaling to each other, and it's much noisier, that part of the process. And they're computing power scores for everybody. And like I said, the power scores for the other group members are noisier than their own. Noisier, right? So not quite as correct. Now, how are they doing this? Now, you think to yourself, well, a monkey is not anywhere near as sophisticated as a human at doing computations. But that's not the right way to think about it. So the right way to think about it is, what can our brains do? Our brains can do amazing things that we have no capacity to articulate. Just think about what it takes to walk down a set of steps. Now make those steps uneven or run in the backcountry over a rocky trail. Your brain, you have no way to articulate the computation that your brain is making so your foot does not catch that rock. But your brain is doing it. You don't catch the rock that often. I catch the rock a lot, actually. But you don't catch the rock that often. And so our brains are capable of amazing computations that we can't describe. We have no conscious access to them. And a lot of what I'm talking about is that kind of computation. And so when I say the monkeys are computing power scores, often you get pushback to a statement like that because people say, well, the monkeys can't count to 100 or whatever, and don't they need to be able to do that? No, that's the conscious part. So that's my answer to your question. I don't know about the processing rate for the subconscious versus the conscious. I do think it is a lot faster, and that definitely aids in the ability to perform these complex computations, but it's not just that.
Okay, thank you, Jessica.
Thank you, everyone.